Hello, welcome to Alpha Phi. Today I have a special guest, Marianne. She is the Tradeline expert. So I really wanted to talk to her because I'm into Tradelines, but I know she's very good at it. She's also an investor, so has a lot of good experience there. But all of this in this recording is going to be kind of our personal opinions and not any advice or anything like that, but hopefully it is entertaining. So Marianne, welcome.
Thank you.
And tell us about you. How did you get started in investing and, you know, some background in history?
Hi, I'm Marianne. And as a child, instead of gifts, we received like red money packets for Chinese New Year. I'm Malaysian, by the way. So from family members or married family members, especially. So since I was young, I was too young to be legally employed. My parents always, every year, they would suggest that I have my money work for me. And that's the start of my investing journey. So I had to learn to commit a portion of my rent money packets received to like an endeavor, like a small food business or a tutoring business, with the expectation of obtaining an additional income or profit. I also majored in finance in college, and I did have the opportunity to set up paper accounts for class projects to learn about equities, stocks, fixed income investments, bonds, and money market funds. So as I was going through college, I had the opportunity to flip these paper accounts live, and I graduated with enough money for a down payment for my first real estate. And so this experience gave me the confidence to continue my investing journey. That's how I started. Thanks, Nash.
That's great. Yeah, it's nice when you get some experience when at a young age. Mine didn't come till a little bit later, but that's really nice. So transitioning to Tradelines, you're the expert in this. So kind of giving people an understanding of what's the kind of time versus money, payback for this kind of activity. After all, it's kind of a side hustle, right? It's not a main hustle, but yeah.
So, I mean, it depends on who you sell it to, but it goes from about $50 to $350 per authorized user per month. And the average commission is around $150 per spot. So if you do the math, you're probably earning like $150 in, say, 4 minutes of work. So it comes out to an hourly wage of about north of $2,000 per hour. So in under 2 hours a year, you're probably like, you could make anywhere between $500 to $10,000. And the only time invested is a few minutes it takes to add an authorized user, and maybe another few minutes to remove the authorized user 2 months later. So that's when, after you get started, right? So before you get started, maybe you need about 1 to 2 hours to, you know, just list your cards and find, you know, who you want to sell it to. Yeah.
Just kind of get organized. Yeah. Get it up and running. That's pretty amazing. I think I calculated at $4,000 or $5,000, but I always try to do it as fast as I can just to get that metric up. But yeah, either way, right? Thousands of dollars per hour is pretty amazing, right? For the time commitment required. So how long have you been doing this, and how did you get introduced or get started with it?
I started in June of 2020, so not too long ago. When I saw a social media post about it, I then researched and chose like Tradeline Supply as my first broker. They do have an extremely comprehensive FAQ section. So I like that. And after that, I listed my credit cards that I wanted to sell my Tradelines on. Yeah.
Nice. So what tips and tricks do you have for optimizing trade lines as a side hustle that you've learned along the way?
So in terms of optimizing, there are really four different factors, and you really need to pull the strings to optimize trade lines as a side hustle. The first and second are the most important. So number one, it's your own credit limit. A card with a credit line over $20,000 will earn the most. Number two is the age of the trade line. So these two are the most important. The first is your credit limit. The second is the age of the trade line. So a card that is more than 10 years old is ideal. If you have anything over 18 years, that commands the highest prices. Number three and four, they're important, but I put them as three and four. So number three is your own credit score. Generally, you will not be able to sell credit lines with the credit score under 700. The higher your credit score, the greater the price per trade line sold. And then number four is the card user. Which card issuer is most favored as it varies, bank policies change. But generally, I would say number one is Barclays. And then you have the Discover Capital one, Chase Bank, Bank of America, mm-hmm. Elan. They're preferred.
Yeah.
So in terms of how you can optimize, I'm just going to give an example. So say you have five cards and each of them are over 10 years old with a credit limit greater than $10,000. You could earn anywhere between $250 to $300 for one authorized user per card every 2 months. So this comes out to about $7,500 to $9,000 per year by changing the cards you use each month. That's tip number one, right? So we talked about the factors. The most important credit, your own credit limit and the age of the trade line. Again, the older the trade line and the higher the credit limit will increase your earnings. So that's really the most important thing to optimize. And then the other tips are just a bit smaller, just to manage these two things. So to increase your own credit limit, try not to use nearly 100% of your own credit limit. Some cards allow you to reallocate and consolidate your credit limits without a hard pull while you wait for a newer card to age. So you can increase your credit limit that weighs to $10,000 or $20,000, right? So for me, I don't only optimize trade lines, I optimize credit cards. So for me, I like my trifecta consists of my trifecta consists of optimizing credit card bonuses, bonus points or deals, and then selling the trade lines, right? Like what we're talking about, and then also optimizing business credit. So I do like to open credit cards to optimize points and age them for trade lines. It's a crazy hobby, I know. And then there are rules. So Nash may put some links down, but you want to check out the Chase 524 rule. Know that in detail, what you need to know about that. And then on,
which basically means you can open up five cards within 24 months, right? That's their rule. Yeah.
Correct. Yes.
Depending on your credit and things, but that's kind of that's what you could do at the max.
Yes. And then, you want to look into Reddit, the R churning channel as well, because they have a flow chart on what cards to open first. So they have like a card recommendation list. So aside from this flowchart, I also like to apply cards where the annual fee is waived the first year with the potential to downgrade to a no fee card after the first year is up. That way I can always age my cards without having to pay the fee. So that allows the card to age, and I can sell that as a trade line without costing me any money at all. I would say these are the main tips to optimize what we're doing.
Yeah, let me just read it back and try and summarize. So you're doing more than just trade lines, but for your old cards, you're using those for trade lines. The older the card and the higher the credit limit, the higher the commission. You can't do anything about aging trade lines. You just have to wait. But what you can do is open up new cards, and you go for cards that have bonuses on opening. So that's kind of a double dip there. And then as they're aging for trade lines, you can actually transfer some of the credit limit on those cards to other aged cards to increase those commissions while the card itself is aging. And then also utilizing the cards with annual fees and stuff. No fee in the first year, but kind of you can also double dip. So using those cards with fees, transfer the credit from that fee card to another card, which means you don't have to pay the fee once it's under a certain limit, right? Something like that. But you're still able to age it and get that initial bonus.
Correct. Thanks for the great summary, Nash.
Yeah. Did I miss anything?
I think you're good. Yeah.
Okay. I'm still learning here. All right. So it sounds great, right? But always the thing I get when I tell people about this is they think it's sketchy. So let's talk about the risks or what the issues might be. So, well, what are the risks with doing trade lines and participating in this type of side hustle, as you understand it?
Sure. I mean, this comes not without risk, right? So number one, it's violating your credit card company's terms of services. You also may assist in identity theft. For me, it's like the unauthorized purchases too, right? Assisting in bank fraud, data breaches, and you risk your account being shut down or accounts being shut down. So if a credit card user or if a credit card issuer sees that you have added a large number of authorized users, usually more than 4 or 6, they may flag your account or shut it down. So then you would risk a lowered credit score on your own personal credit score, especially if that was your oldest or largest line of credit, if one of your accounts ends up being closed. Mm-hmm. I see that as the biggest risk.
Yes. So those were scary words, but it's essentially the credit card company's policy. They don't like it because it increases all those scary thing risks for them. And so what they would do is shut your card down and cancel it, essentially, which means normally the highest commission cards are the oldest ones, which that's how it impacts your score, right?
Yeah, correct.
Yeah. Okay. We've heard of some people getting their cards shut down. Are there any companies that are kind of should watch out for, or different things we should do to try and, you know, fly under the radar with that?
I mean, it's emotional. I mean, we've heard of Chase, and Chase, I mean, it's an emotional journey if your Chase card gets shut down, because, you know, Chase points are very valuable. I haven't had my Chase card shut down, but I've had Bank of America shut me down, but they say I could reapply in December. So I don't know. I just got shut down. So I'll see if I could reapply in December. I don't know. But yeah, it's first of all emotional. But then again, there's a ton of credit card companies out there, right? So if Chase mm-hmm. doesn't like you, maybe take your business to Amex.
Yeah. And it's kind of, you don't want to have more than say like 1 or 2 authorized users, additional authorized users on your card at any given time. Seems to be kind of the golden rule, but even then, sometimes with Chase or others, they might still flag it over time as they see many, many, many being accumulated and removed over time, it seems like. And then there's cards like Barclays where you can add numerous and they seem to be more okay with that at the same time.
Yeah. So with Barclays, you can add 6. Well, I've added 7 before, but usually 6 at a time. But they do cap it at 30 authorized users during the life of the card. So I would recommend, okay, opening your Chase up first because they have a Chase 524, but Barclays has 624 rule. So you may want to open a Barclays as your sixth card.
Right. So they actually allow you to open up 6 and 24 months.
Yes.
And they're great because you can add lots of authorized users, but they have a lifetime limit on their card. So maybe I'm personally seasoning a lot of Barclays cards currently. And you can also move your credit from those seasoning cards to your main Tradelines card or cards. So that's what I'm doing. Is that how you would do it as the expert?
Yeah, I mean, that's great. Great practice. Okay.
All right. So after you're set up with a broker, what are the steps and kind of how much work does this take to set up this side hustle?
Sure. So first, you want to decide which credit cards you want to sell your trade lines on. Like after hearing all the risks we talked about, say if you really don't want to sacrifice your cheese, you know, you can opt out of that, that's fine. Next, you want to wait for the broker to connect you with the seller. So you would usually get an email with further instructions once this happens. And then the next step is then you would add the authorized user to your card. And then finally, you would remove the authorized user from your card. You will receive a notification again on when you can do so. The user usually stays on your card for about 2 months, after which the broker would tell you when you can remove the authorized user.
And you get paid too. They said, thank you. Yeah, you get paid. You can remove them now normally.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. And they wait for payment just to kind of confirm that like the card company did report to this authorized user's credit bureau and they did see the benefit from, buying the trade line, essentially. That's why they're doing it, is to kind of improve their credit, right, for something.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So it seems pretty easy. Some of those card companies, you can do all that online, which takes minutes. Others are a little more painful where you have to call in and kind of remove them over the phone, which is always annoying trying to get through, but it's pretty easy, right?
I would say so. Maybe takes a maximum 6 minutes per card you sell. Yeah.
Yeah. Cool. So we're optimizers as investors. We try to minimize expenses, and most people's biggest expense in life, whether we realize it or not, is taxes. So I know we're not tax professionals or anything, but in your experience, what is this income classified as, and any feedback there from your experience?
Sure. I've always filed it as 1099, or I've always gotten a 1099 for them.
Mm-hmm.
But I guess it could be miscellaneous income too, but please consult a CPA on this. It's like, yeah, National, you're not advisors, really. Just talking about own personal experiences here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's my experience too. And it's definitely active income. So I know there's a lot of real estate investors out there that we're friends with. So this was super enlightening. Any final comments on trade lines or otherwise that you want to add that we didn't cover today?
I think another question people ask is, can those authorized users spend with your credit card, right? And I guess as an authorized user, the Tradeline buyer could technically request a card sent to their address and make charges on their card. But I, as a risk precaution, I do always put notifications in and also minimize what they can use, etc.
Mm-hmm.
But that's just me. It's a one-time setup, so I would encourage that.
Yeah, and they don't. That's a great point. So like when you add the authorized user, it asks where to ship the card. And normally the default is your own address being the primary card holder. but always good to double check and make sure that is the case so they don't get a card at all. Normally it comes to you and you can just hang on to it and destroy it or whatever, but yeah, that's a great point. Another good question.
Thanks, Nash, for the opportunity. I hope, you know, people find this useful as a side hustle.
Thank you, Marianne. I really appreciate it. Take care. Have a good morning over there in Malaysia.
Thank you. See ya.
Bye.